Hi there, church. Welcome to worship. I'm your pastor, Pastor Tim Turner. Let's start by praising God together.
There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its word. It sounds like music.
Loved us. Before we ever loved you, you were reaching out to us. So God, we invite you to come wake our hearts up. As we worship you in spirit and in truth, come wake us up, remind us of that deep love you have for us. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Friends, this morning we start a new sermon series. Before we get there, I want to read a couple of passages of scripture. One's from the Gospel of Matthew. It's Matthew chapter 7, verses 21 through 23. So hear the word of God. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do many deeds of power in your name? Then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Go away from me, you evildoers. Second passage comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 13. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith, so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God. You know, year after year, Easter, the Sunday that just passed, Easter is the busiest time of year for me. I mean, I always think it's going to be Christmas that's the busiest time of year for me. I mean, Christmas has all the parties, has all the planning, has all the shopping and extra driving and extra events. But year after year, Easter is the holiday that wraps me up in this breakneck kind of speed just to get things done. Yeah, I got caught a bit by a song that came on the radio last week as I was driving between St. Augustine and Center. I'm sure you know the song. I'm in a hurry to get things done. Oh, I'm rushing, rushing till life's no fun. I'm in a hurry and don't know why. Now, doesn't that speak of us? I'm in a hurry and don't know why. Please, come on, somebody out there, tell me I'm not the only one. We are all in a hurry, aren't we? I mean, it doesn't matter if we're retired already or if we're still pushing the 40-plus hour grind. If we work from home or work from the office. If we fill our days with unpaid activities or if we're still pushing for that paycheck. It doesn't really matter how we spend our time. We do most certainly spend our time. And we spend it to the full. We're notorious as a people for having no time left. I mean, how many times in one week do we hear ourselves saying one of these two phrases? Time got away from me. Or how about the second? I think the second is one of our favorites. I just didn't have enough time for that. I'm in a hurry and don't know why. Tell me I'm not the only one. Now, today's passage of scripture I'm going to read, it has nothing to do with being busy. But what it does have to do with, it has everything to do with, in fact, with the why and the what behind our busy lives. We start a sermon series today that looks at seven different letters sent to seven different churches and recorded in that cryptic book of Revelation, the last book in our Bible. And the first letter that we're going to look at today is sent to the church in Ephesus. It speaks a challenging message about the direction of our hearts, the aiming of our love as we go about our breakneck speed, as we run and run and run in our busy lives. So we'll start here in Revelation chapter 2, and I'm going to read the first seven verses. Hear the word of God. To the angel in the church, of the church in Ephesus, write, these are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks among the seven golden lampstands. I know your works, your toil and your patient endurance. I know that you cannot tolerate evildoers. You have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, and have found them to be false. I also know that you are enduring patiently and bearing up for the sake of my name, and that you have not grown weary. But I have this against you. You have abandoned the love you had at first. Remember then from what you have fallen. Repent. And do the works you did at first. If not, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place, unless you repent. Yet this is to your credit. You hate the works of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Let anyone who has an ear listen to what the Spirit is saying to the churches. To everyone who conquers, I will give permission to eat from the tree of life that is in the paradise of God. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God. You know, we can imagine the gravity, the seriousness of getting a letter like this in our mailbox, of reading this letter to Ephesus for the first time it was ever opened. The Apostle John would have been the person who sent this letter to the church in Ephesus. John was the church leader that was writing this book of Revelation. John was the one marooned on the island of Patmos, the one seeing and hearing this marvelous vision we have in Revelation of Christ's second coming, of the end of the world as we know it. But most of all, if we were in Ephesus reading this letter for the first time, we'd be reading a letter from our very own founding pastor. John was the elder who served the church in Ephesus through many vital years of their early growth. And surely that congregation in Ephesus was desperate to learn the condition of their pastor. Their pastor who was currently sentenced to death by the Roman government. The pastor who was currently abandoned to die on an isolated island. John writes to his dearly beloved home church, first and foremost. This is the first of seven letters. And John sends that first one to the beloved church of Ephesus. And as we imagine the gravity of reading this letter for the first time, we have to also imagine that beloved pastor in our lives. That one who sticks in our memory is someone whose gospel work truly changed the course of our life. Or maybe it's not a pastor for you. Maybe it's a Sunday school teacher, a former mentor, a grandma, grandpa, a mom, dad, maybe an aunt or uncle. It's that person, though, currently sitting in a lonely place writing this letter, currently stranded to die in an island we'll never reach. It's that person who has made such a deep impact on our faith who writes this letter as we read it. And it's a tough letter, isn't it? Remember then from where you have fallen, verse 5 says. Repent. Do the works you did at first. It's a tough letter. Or else your lampstand gets removed. That's one of those cryptic ways in the book of Revelation for saying that the congregation in Ephesus would crumble, would fall away, the church would shut its doors if it did not repent. That's what it means to remove a lampstand. And of course, that's a huge deal for any church, but especially for Ephesus. Ephesus was a bustling port city on the coast of Asia, the gateway to commerce for that entire region in that time when this letter was written. I mean, it was a busy, busy place there in Ephesus. An immense gospel work had occurred in that place. I mean, God had done marvelous things in that large city, through that large city. The Apostle Paul, for instance, Paul made Ephesus a main place for missionary support when he went back through town on his second set of travels. I mean, in some sense, Ephesus was the very first church who ever had a missionary conference. The mighty preacher Apollos also spent quite a bit of time in Ephesus, along with his companions Aquila and Priscilla, who were also companions of Paul. Apollos, he led the people in Ephesus, many people to the faith there in Ephesus. They raised up the church in Ephesus to be a mighty force for the gospel. So here we have the Apostle John, the Apostle Paul, Apollos, Aquila, Priscilla. In other words, Ephesus was a heavy weight for the gospel. Ephesus was raised up by top-tier church leaders. And John's letter cannot ignore the truth of how vibrant this church was. In fact, he writes one of the greatest affirmations of all seven letters he writes to his home church of Ephesus. Look at verse 2. I know your works, John says, your toil and your patient endurance. I know that you cannot tolerate evildoers. You have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, and have found them to be false. I also know that you are enduring patiently and bearing up for the sake of my name, that you have not grown weary. They have not polluted the gospel, even though wolves and sheep clothing have come among them time and time again. They have not grown weary. Their gospel labor continues with vitality and fervor. In that busy, busy port city, they continue to toil, to evangelize, to bring people to the faith and raise up the next generation of gospel leaders. I mean, this is a powerful church discipled by powerful gospel leaders. And yet they still have a flaw. In all the hustle and bustle, they've lost a vision for something so central to our faith that it threatens to undo the entire gospel work of that marvelously productive place. I'm in a hurry, but I've forgotten why. I'm in a hurry and don't know why. Look at verse 4 with me. But I have this against you, that you have abandoned the love you had at first. Remember then from what you have fallen. Repent and do the works you did at first. If not, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place, unless you repent. At what point does our busyness have no heart? At what point does our busyness become sheer obligation? At what point are we doing great work and with whatever our work is, but it's just from basic duty? It's just from acquired responsibility. At what point are we just going through life, taking another step, lifting another finger, only to make it to the next event, the next day, the next week? At what point are we doing marvelous work that makes this world a better place? But our heart, our love has completely faded in the background. And all the busy strain on our time, we somehow blinked. And next week comes May. 1/3 of the year already gone. I'm in a hurry and don't know why. And in all of that running, did our love for God and others truly become more complete, more full? In our hustle and our bustle to be more productive in the gospel work, did our heart become more fully alive? Did our love for God expand, go deeper, become more real? Or did we simply do great work out of sheer obligation to get things done? Did we simply go through the motions, our rhythms, just to make it another day, to pay another bill, to accomplish one more achievement? I'm in a hurry and don't know why. I've completely forgotten. Look at verse 4 again. I have this against you, John says. You have abandoned the love you had at first. The church in Ephesus was probably the most powerful gospel church in the entire world at the time of this writing. But it's entirely possible to do amazing humanitarian work even with a heart as cold as stone. It's possible to help a neighbor in need and not really care about their name, their story, to not really love them. Let our love go deeper. It's possible to build and plant and toil and even move mountains, but not really have true love growing in our hearts. See, sometimes we do great acts of service, but it's really service for self. It's service for self as we try to get that warm, fuzzy feeling, or try to get that recognition, or try simply to stay busy. Or perhaps we turn around and we find ourselves simply doing what we've always done. I mean, the work just has to keep on happening. It can't stop. Somebody's got to do it. And so from sheer duty, we keep the march going. And yet our heart is no longer in it. We're no longer passionate. We no longer have a love that is growing or that really cares about the people we're serving. Friends, these are all symptoms of an Ephesus problem. When we completely forget the love we once had for the deep things of God. When we no longer change the world because we're compelled by God's love, but rather because we're compelled to get things done. And yet it's all empty if that's our only pursuit. Without love, it's all dead. It's all worthless. It's a clashing gong, a banging cymbal. It doesn't matter if we don't have any love in it. That passage from Matthew, quoting the words of Jesus, it's so rich in this moment. In the last days, which is what Revelation writes about, in the last days, some people will find themselves face to face with God, and they'll say to God, God, didn't we cast out demons in your name? Didn't we proclaim the gospel? Didn't we do mighty deeds of power all in the name of God's kingdom? But God will look those people in the eyes and say, I never knew you. You never stopped long enough to really meet me. You never truly gave your heart to me. I never knew you. Because while you certainly did great work, there was never an ounce of relationship in your religion. Friends, that all ought to shake us awake. Even as a preacher and pastor of the gospel, I find my own heart so frequently flirting with this place of absent love. But Christ did not die so that we'd make ourselves busy. Christ did not die so that we'd be productive. Christ did not die so we'd be distracted so much with building God's kingdom that we never even love God. No. Instead, Christ died so that our lives can be joined with God. Christ died so that we could know the love of God. Christ died so that our hearts could come alive again and we could truly encounter the love of God. That this would not be just some religion, but it would be something that is not found anywhere else in the world, a true relationship with God. Don't you know that? Don't we feel that? Can't we want that? That deep love for God? Some of us have never tasted that love. This Christianity thing has simply been out of obligation. It's simply been because it's what we always do, because it's what our parents did, because it's who we are. There's no love in some of our hearts for God. There is deeper promises in the gospel where our hearts can come alive. And maybe some of us know exactly what I'm talking about, but it's been years, decades even, since we felt that kind of love for God stirring in our hearts. Friends, now is the time. Now is the time to turn the ship around. Now is the time to connect our hearts with God, for God has already been reaching out to us, calling us to a deeper level of love. Let those who have ears hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Friends, let's sing one more song together as we give our hearts more fully to God. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, oh my soul, rejoice, take joy, my King, in what you hear, let it be a sweet, sweet. Friends, may we go from here in the love of God, yes, but giving our hearts to a true love for God also. There's a deeper gospel promises awaiting us. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray.